going to be posted.
Okay, I'm really excited to welcome you all this afternoon. Thank you for coming out on a Friday. It's a real testament to Dr. Swist that you're all here, and I think it's going to be an amazing talk. We're very excited to have Dr. Swist with us at Miami this year. He is a visiting assistant professor. Some of you are lucky enough to have him right now in your classes, but I want to encourage you also to register for his EPIC class next semester. So this is the moment to give a commercial break. If you like what you hear, please make sure you sign up for class 211, Ancient Greek and Roman EPIC. So Dr. Swist earned his PhD from the University of Iowa with a dissertation about the reception of the seven kings of Rome in imperial historiography from Tiberius to Theodosius. Some of his research interests are in the period of late antiquity, which is really exciting for us because it's not something the rest of us do, so we're really excited to have someone in that particular field with us. In that area, he's given a really impressive number of conference papers, and he also has quite a few publications on the Emperor Julian and also the writer Libanius. In addition, he also has a research interest in classical reception and the role of classical reception in connection to heavy metal music, and that's what he's going to be sharing it with us today. So he has an article about that entitled Satan's Empire, Ancient Rome's Anti-Christian Appeal in Extreme Metal. And then he also does some really interesting outreach that maybe you can ask him about afterwards, where he shares a lot of his research through other groups outside the academy online. So he's really been involved in trying to introduce a wide range of audiences to the ancient world, including some of its uses in heavy metal music. So we're really excited to have him talk about that field of research today. And you are all here for the paper by Spartan Law, We Rock, Laconophilia in Heavy Metal Music. Please join me in welcoming Dr. Jeremy Smith.
Thanks so much, Denise, and thank you so much to everyone who came, and especially to my colleagues in the Department of Classics for giving me this opportunity to talk today. And lastly, I would like to do this as a plug. Miami University has a heavy metal club, and the president of Matthew Cohen is right there. If you want to talk to him afterward, so that's its meeting time, so I consider checking it out. Okay. Since this is a talk about music, I thought we would start by listening to some music. I've got a few lined up, but we'll start with this one. Get a couple more later on, so we won't listen to all of this, but comes from the city of Sparta. Some say he's the best. He bears one thing on his mind, free all the rest. So runs the song Gladiator by the Los Angeles band Soundbarrier in 1986. As one of the first all-black heavy metal bands, Soundbarrier sought to disrupt the white hegemony of the musical genre. Their mission resonates with this song about Spartacus, the archetypal rebel slave who challenged the might of Rome. Ancient sources identify Spartacus as a Thracian, but Soundbarrier, intentionally or not, derives Spartacus' name from Sparta. Such a national origin, the song suggests, accounts not only for his status as a consummate warrior, but also his drive to liberate his brothers in arms from imperial oppression. While a handful of bands earlier in the 1980s, such as Iron Maiden, had dabbled in classical myth and history for lyrical inspiration, this is the first recorded mention of Sparta in metal. It would not be the last. And today I offer some preliminary explanations why Sparta has appealed to metalheads worldwide. While some artists have demonstrably accessed the ancient sources, heavy metal's reception of Sparta is overwhelmingly inspired by and filtered through the products of Laconophilia in popular media and culture at large. Yet these ancient and modern versions of Sparta are transformed into a paradigm for heavy metal itself. Sparta's symbolism of strength and defiance has appealed greatly to the core ethos of metal and its concomitant subculture. While many bands appropriate Sparta to celebrate their Greek or European heritage, some even harnessing it for extreme political agendas, the majority, I would argue, see in the warrior citizens of Lacedaemon a reflection of their own metal subculture, where the few are united and empowered by their opposition to the many, of personal autonomy against the oppressive systems of the mainstream. First, a few words about the academic study of this music. With metal now taken seriously, finally, as an art form with a distinctive and diverse global subculture, the field of metal studies has in this millennium grown into a maturing discipline, or rather interdiscipline, involving musicologists, sociologists, historians, and, sure enough, classicists. Today's topic also falls into the category of classical reception, a subdiscipline that, like heavy metal, has recently gained recognition as being just as serious and essential to the field as traditional philology. Reception studies not only examines how a text like Herodotus' histories is recontextualized in a later art form, like metal, but also how the later art form in turn impacts our reading of Herodotus. As you can see here, the study of classical reception in metal has thus far involved a handful of scholars, who, like myself, double as fans of the music. While this all seems to be a rather niche research area, my experience at least has shown a wide interest in the topic among both classicists and metalheads. Amid the richness of heavy metal classicism, Laconophilia in metal is but one of the most recent incarnations of this phenomenon of love and admiration for all things laconic, that is, pertaining to Sparta, the militaristic city-state that dominated much of southern Greece in the archaic and classical periods until its defeat by Thebes at Leuctra in 371 BCE. We're almost there, Greek Civ. While certain men in Sparta's arch-rival Athens admired Sparta during its height, it was ironically enough not long before Leuctra and the decline of Spartan supremacy that Laconophilia as an ancient Greek phenomenon took off. For it was then that Xenophon gave us our first surviving account of Spartan society at home. Not only its political constitution, but also its rigorous state-run education system, one that forged all males who survived the eugenic scrutiny of their infancy into a citizen class of professional soldiers. With similar antipathy to Athenian democracy, another student of Socrates named Plato modeled his ideal society, the Republic, on the real society of Sparta. 4 centuries later, Plutarch indulged a nostalgia for Greek glory under the Roman Empire with a number of works on Spartan society, such as The Life of Lycurgus and The Sayings of Spartan Women. And so we can see Laconophilia was at its origin a reaction to these authors' respective mainstreams. Yet how real was the Sparta of these non-Spartan admirers, separated by space and at least a century's time from the men who fell at Thermopylae and the women who gave birth to those real men? Laconophilia distorts even our so-called primary sources for Sparta, as there is little written in archaeological evidence from the Spartans themselves to paint a more accurate picture. These ancient accounts from non-Spartans form the basis of what we moderns call the Spartan mirage, which, for better or worse, spellbound philosophers, statesmen, and artists throughout modern history, from Machiavelli to Jacques-Louis David to Adolf Hitler. Another essential component to modern Laconophilia is the Battle of Thermopylae, as recounted by the histories of Herodotus, another outsider, Ethan Halicarnassus. This was the first infantry engagement with the massive task force of Xerxes, king of the vast multinational Persian Empire. In the face of this impending conquest of Greece, all but 31 city-states preemptively capitulated. Sparta took command of this so-called Hellenic alliance, which designated the pass of Thermopylae and nearby straits of Artemisium as the most suitable choke points to halt the Persian army and navy, respectively, from advancing into central Greece. Exaggerating numbers to enhance the Greek achievement, Herodotus counts Xerxes' forces at over 2.5 million, though modern historians reduce it to no more than 300,000. Barry Strauss would argue 150,000. And this includes the 10,000 royal bodyguards called the Immortals. The Hellenic alliance sent to Thermopylae a force of 7,000, due in part to religious obligations. It being mid-August, 480 BCE, there was a truce was declared throughout Greece to allow travel to Olympia, where Zeus was honored with the Olympic Games. Furthermore, the 8,000-strong army of Spartan citizens was also held back by the very same festival of Apollo Carneus that made them late to the party at Marathon a decade prior. For this reason, Leonidas, one of Sparta's two kings, was permitted to take only his own royal bodyguard of 300 Spartiates, though he also brought 1,000 hoplites of perioikoi, that is the second-class free citizens of Laconia, plus as many helots, state-owned Greek serfs who were regularly humiliated and even terrorized by public decree. It was the labor of these two groups that supported the Spartiates as a class of professional soldiers. For 2 days, the narrowness of the pass between the mountains and sea, combined with the determination of the more heavily armed Greeks, converted Xerxes' numerical advantage into heavy casualties. Yet on the third day, the Greeks found themselves soon to be outflanked after a local Greek trader named Ephialtes informed Xerxes of a path through the mountains leading to the Greek rear. Leonidas dismissed the majority of his forces, but stayed behind with the Spartan contingent, plus a few hundred Thespians and Thebans, looking out for the safety of the returning force, but also perhaps his own glory. And so they made their last stand with spear, sword, tooth, and nail until all had perished, but not before taking many enemies down with them. Xerxes' forces advanced to Athens, which they burned to the ground. The retreating Greek forces regrouped and, with their full complement of men and ships, dealt the Persians a decisive defeats at Salamis and Plataea. Greece was liberated and the Persians would never return. Though modern historians debate whether Thermopylae had been a strategic success or failure, it was remembered by ancients and moderns alike as not only a sacrificial holding action that inspired subsequent Greek victories, but also a powerful symbol of the defense of liberty against tyranny, or more accurately, of political self-determination against foreign imperialism. Their valor, specifically of the Spartans, was first immortalized in the epitaph of the poet Simonides inscribed at the battlefield. "Stranger, tell the Spartans that here we lie, obeying their words," end quote. These words have been taken to be that of their law, that is, the constitution of Lycurgus that they were defending, but especially those governing their conduct in battle. Quote, "Not to retreat from the battlefield, even when outnumbered, to maintain formation, and to either win or die," like the Game of Thrones, right? "Surrender is not an option, and it is better to die fighting than live as a coward and a pariah." It was the memorialization of this battle that brought Sparta into the popular imagination in the aftermath of World War II. The 1940s saw Greece suffer first a Nazi occupation and then a devastating civil war that ended in the victory of the American-backed Greek government army over the Soviet-backed Democratic Army of Greece. The U.S. helped symbolize this halting of the advance of communism by funding a memorial to Leonidas and the 300 at the site of Thermopylae in 1955. That's it right there. In 1962, at the time of the Cuban Missile Crisis and the erection of the Berlin Wall, the Rudolf Maté film, The 300 Spartans, similarly suggested an analogy of Greece and Persia to NATO and the Warsaw Pact. But for the popularization of Sparta in the 21st century, the groundwork was laid in 1998 by Stephen Pressfield's best-selling novel, Gates of Fire, and Frank Miller's comic, 300. Both recounting Thermopylae from the perspective of a helot squire and a Spartiate survivor, respectively. The Spartiate's version won out for film adaptation by Zack Snyder in 2006, following Ridley Scott's Gladiator and Wolfgang Peterson's Troy in inaugurating a resurgence of the classical world on the silver screen. Like its Cold War predecessor, Snyder's 300 was quickly contextualized alongside the film Kingdom of Heaven in a post-9/11 America embroiled in wars in Iraq, Afghanistan, and potentially Iran. That latter country understandably condemned the film for its orientalizing and dehumanizing portrayal of their Persian ancestors. Outside the Middle East, the film was a box office hit, grossing over $450 million. Its computerized bringing to life of the graphic novel influenced subsequent cinematography, and its dialogue is still frequently quoted in popular culture. Alongside the ubiquitous "This is Sparta" are a few laconic apophthegms, all attributed to Leonidas by Plutarch. "If their arrows will blot out the sun, then we'll fight in the shade. Tonight we dine in hell." And in response to the Persian demand to lay down their weapons, "Come and get them." This being the famous molon labe, appropriated by various groups, among them strident defenders of the Second Amendment. Included also are in the film are quotations of Plutarch's sayings of Spartan women, such as, come back with your shield or on it, eton e epitas, and only we Spartan women give birth to real men. Over a decade after 300, Laconophilia is going strong, evident by the film sequel, Rise of an Empire, in 2014, as well as the video game Assassin's Creed Odyssey. Just this past week, we've seen it invoked in both politics and professional sports, and Republicans, a few Republicans during the impeachment inquiry, and the New England Patriots, Bill Belichick, earning his 300th win. Interesting comparisons there. Okay. Anyway, Sparta's also inspired dozens of self-help guides, especially geared toward men, some returning full circle to the origins of Laconophilia in Greek philosophy. And again, this was just posted as well. There has also been a lively debate in public scholarship recently over how the popular admiration of Sparta could be problematic, framed as a symptom of a society flirting with fascism. Historians such as Sarah Bond and Mike Cole affirm that a militaristic city-state that sponsors eugenic infanticide, along with the exploitation and terrorism of an underclass of non-citizen subjects, ought not to be so glorified. They cite Nazi Germany's emulation of Sparta as precedent for contemporary Laconophilia among proponents of the alt-right, such as Steve Bannon. Their critics, on the other hand, maintain that to admire specific aspects of Spartan civilization is not to endorse the whole package, and that participation in Laconophilia is not to endorse the political forces that nevertheless fuel it. As in contemporary popular culture, so the 300 franchise profoundly impacted Sparta's reception in heavy metal. In fact, we can quantify this. I have thus far identified 94 bands who have written songs on Sparta. Okay? And the distribution by dates of release has a strong correlation with the premiere of the first 300 film. Right there. And as you can see, the correlations also seem to exist with the release of similar media, such as the original comic book, the movie sequel, and the video game. I have also noted some historical events, such as 9/11, that may also, and the 7/7 bombings in London, that may also correlate to a pronounced cultural interest in Sparta and Thermopylae as a so-called clash of East and West. Other relevant factors to keep in mind include the global increase in metal bands over this 20-year period, as well as the recent resurgence of traditional heavy metal and power metal, the subgenres that most often treat historical themes. That said, there are Spartan theme songs in all subgenres of metal, including thrash metal, doom metal, black metal, and death metal. Negligible thematic differences in lyrics preclude, for now, an analysis by subgenre, so I'll spare you those details. Sorry, guys. I acquired and organized this data by using the Encyclopedia Metallum, an online database of every metal band past and present with any recorded material. And you can tell they did not consult a classicist when naming this thing. For well over a year, I have been using this archive to assemble a master database of metal songs based on Greco-Roman mythology and history. I have so far cataloged over 1,000 songs, and those on Sparta make up roughly 10%. You can see in the screenshot of the first 18 songs in the database, there are already three such songs on Sparta by three different artists. I examined the lyrics of the total 125 Spartan songs and recorded the frequency of various quotations of ancient and modern sources, as well as a variety of themes. This methodology consists more of distant than close readings, and largely for those for the present, close readings of representative case studies of individual songs and albums. My goal for now is to grasp the bigger picture, appreciating full well the ever-apt metaphor in this context that the devil can indeed be in the details. That 300 serves as the predominant and even exclusive source for a large amount of these songs is evidenced not only in album artwork, but even more so in the lyrics' direct quotations of the film, and in some cases, deviation from the Herodotean toward the Hollywoodian narrative. 300 is not unique in this regard. For instance, the song titled Achilles by the band Jag Panzer, released within a year of Wolfgang Petersen's Troy, refers to Patroclus as Achilles' cousin, contrary to the ancient sources. However, before we start wagging our fingers, we should acknowledge that as heavy metal's self-definition is at its core a reaction to popular culture, so its appropriation of the classical world will often follow suit. One of the most influential artists in underground metal and founder of the Swedish band Bathory, who performed under the pseudonym Korthon, acknowledged in his manifesto for the new subgenre of Viking metal the logic of receiving popular rather than historically accurate accounts of the past. Like many of the Greek bands who sing of Achilles and Leonidas as a retrieval of cultural heritage and expression of national pride, Korthon originated the practice in the early 90s of Scandinavian bands celebrating their own Viking ancestors. Korthon traded in traditional metallic themes of evil and darkness for, quote, proud and strong Norsemen, shiny blades of broadswords, dragon ships, and party till you puke type of living up there in the great halls. An image of my ancestors and that era not too far away from the romanticized and, to a great extent, utterly wrong image most people have of that period in time through countless Hollywood productions, end quote. This approach equally applies when bands receive the history and mythology of Greece and Rome, as the popular vision of warfare and decadence and related topics resonates strongly with metal's core themes and imagery of masculinity, power, and sensual liberation. That said, bands who classify this frequently can and do consult scholarly sources, ancient and scholarly sources, for their material with all of their biases, especially the Greek and Italian bands who were raised on them. Yet, like Viking metal, what the classicist Chris Fletcher dubs Mediterranean metal need not be the exclusive province of bands from Greece or Italy. The vast majority of classically themed songs, moreover, do not come from bands devoted mainly to these themes, but are individual songs by bands whose lyrical concepts are much less circumscribed. This is especially the case with songs on Sparta. Such a global reach can be quantified by searching, again, the Encyclopedia Metallum for songs whose titles or lyrics contain the words Sparta, Spartan, Thermopylae, and Leonidas. With the 18 bands from Greece forms, while the 18 bands from Greece formed a plurality, the search resulted in 94 bands from 30 countries all over Europe, North and South America, and Australia. Following Greece's 18 are the US with 12, Germany with 10, Italy with 9, and Brazil, France, the Netherlands, Poland, and the UK with 4 apiece. Beyond the patriotism of Greek bands, this distribution by country can partly be accounted for by the general population and metal bands per capita in each country. On the other hand, many of these countries are the traditional bases of classicism, classical scholarship, and historical claims to being the heirs to Greek civilization. Okay, you might expect more, say, Swedish bands, but it's pretty low. Okay. Where was it? For the US in particular, the emulation of Sparta's mixed constitution is as old as our own constitution, and evident in the names of many towns and school mascots. Additionally, the cause of the underdog is ingrained in the national mythology, from the Revolution to the Alamo to the Chosen Reservoir. Beyond showing the global reach of Laconophilia in metal, my search of the Encyclopedia Metallum's database reveals that Thermopylae is the ancient battle most cited by name in metal lyrics, and this is only songs where the actual word Thermopylae appears. Equally telling is how the battles of Alesia and the Teutoburg Forest come in second and third. Like Thermopylae, Alesia was a last stand, that of the Celtic ancestors of the French nation in their resistance against Caesar's conquest of Gaul in 52 BCE. The Teutoburg Forest, while a victory rather than last stand, was the successful repulsion of the Romans from Germany in 9 CE. While Greek, French, and German bands predominate with songs on these respective battles, as symbols of resistance to imperialism, they are all sung by bands across the globe. Metal's attraction to narratives of the fatal defiance of few against many is perhaps epitomized in the 2016 album by the Swedish band Sabaton, titled The Last Stand. The album's first song, Sparta, makes Thermopylae the archetype of subsequent last stands, such as those of the American 77th Battalion in the Argonne Forest, the 500 Samurai at Shiroyama, and perhaps controversially, the Germans in Berlin in 1945. Sabaton have become a highly popular band, and their song Sparta contains several elements common to most Laconophilic metal songs. So I thought we would listen to and watch their lyric video and dissect it a bit. Try not to blast you away. Fanfare of trumpets gives way to shouts of "Ahoo!" inspired by the Snyder film, along with the stylized spatterings of blood. The lyrics begin with revival versions, displaying an early modern drawing of a man on horseback dressed in a turban and long flowing robes, resembling more an Ottoman sultan or vizier than an Achaemenid Persian. For the Spartans, in contrast, the focus is on the hardness of their bodies and their armor. Under Leonidas, the Spartans bond as a small band of brothers against a fateful horde of faceless Persians, whom the Spartans are commanded to slaughter. The burning pride of Hellenic unity matches the fire of the hot gates, which are suggested to be the gates of hell by both the rising flames and to the Gustave Doré engraving of Dante and Virgil crossing the river Styx into the Inferno. The chorus, moreover, underlines the ultimate objective of the Spartans' last stand, to achieve the immortality of everlasting glory. Then and again, Sing of 300 Men alludes to the tradition, stretching from the battle's immediate aftermath to today, of prolonging this immortality through poetry and song. The second set of verses contrasts this immortal fame with the eternal infamy of Ephialtes, the Greek traitor. He is cited frequently in metal songs to suggest that if not for his treason, the Spartans would have easily won the battle. While Sabaton are known for their avid reading of world history, the reading of Sparta touches upon several themes shared by Spartan metal songs in general. As for the imagery in this video, it is not necessarily Sabaton's creative hand, but that of the label Nuclear Blast Records, and so we can see here how the marketing of Laconophilia in metal can go beyond the bands themselves, as the trifecta of artists, media, and fans all contribute to this discourse. We may add to this several fan-made music videos on YouTube that use scenes from films like 300 quite often. Sabaton's Sparta is a recent product of Laconophilia in metal. Its origins are in that of metal itself. Originating with the music of Black Sabbath in the working class industrial cities of Birmingham, England in 1970, heavy metal music departed from its rock and roll roots not only with heavier instrumentation and darker melodies, such as the so-called Devil's Tritone, but also with lyrics that explore the darker side of human nature. And while rock optimistically praised love as a uniting force against mainstream society, metal counterculture united its fan base of socially alienated youth around a collective pessimism and resentment. Black Sabbath songs like War Pigs and Electric Funeral, my favorite one, indulge in the imagery of humanity's darkest potential for violence and evil. While Sabbath's music was a protest, subsequent metal began exploring how war could be a venue for the highest expressions of human freedom and masculine power. One only look at album covers to see the hyper-masculine warrior as a symbol of empowerment empowerment this music aims to instill. This retrieval of human authenticity can combine with an interest in history where such models may be found, Iron Maiden's Alexander the Great being an influential example. History is likewise a form of escapism to a time before modern society allegedly made people weak and submissive, as they view it. One recalls how Homer spoke of how three men, as they were in his own day, could not lift a stone that the heroes at Troy could hurl at their opponents with ease. Combined, these fascinations with violence, irrational power, and freedom from social restraints form the core of the heavy metal ethos as theorized by the founding mother of metal studies, Dina Weinstein. In a manner of speaking, metal's religion is a form of ditheism, of chaos and Dionysus. Chaos is the antithesis of order, symbolizing metal's inherent opposition to systems of social, political, religious, and economic conformity and control. Dionysus, in turn, is a god of spiritual liberation of the self from the control of rationality and socially prescribed behavior, and thus the freedom to gratify one's animal instincts. Many parallels can be made between a heavy metal concert and a Dionysian ritual, including the consumption of alcohol and trance-inducing movements, though ritual dismemberment is more often in the lyrics than on stage. The first metal song devoted exclusively to Sparta is closer in time and spirit to metal's chaotic and Dionysian roots, a song called Moment of Truth, released in 1998 by the crossover thrash metal band Stormtroopers of Death. Founder Scott Ian had previously written two mythologically themed songs with his more famous band Anthrax, namely The Howling Furies and Medusa. So it may be no coincidence that Moment of Truth came out the same year as the publication of Pressfield's Gates of Fire and Miller's 300. And this will be the last song that I make you listen to. Just for some variety here.
Thank you.
this wonderful song's lyrics set much precedent for integrating common tropes of heavy metal lyrics into the Herodotean narrative of Thermopylae. Overall, the song argues that it is better to fight and die for one's liberty rather than submit to slavery, reflecting the Greek belief that such was the nature of Persian rule. The commonplace preference to die on one's feet than live on one's knees is an expression of personal autonomy in defiance of authority, corroborated by a channeling of homicidal and suicidal instincts into that cause. These instincts in turn explore the horrors of battlefield mortality, as the hyperbolic effluence of blood and violence against the human body recalls the many gruesome death scenes of Homer's Iliad. Next is the exoticization of the Persians' dress, which Herodotus tells us used to frighten Greek soldiers, but here the Spartans resemble the Athenians facing this sight fearlessly at Marathon. The characteristic lack of substance in the Persian side negates their numerical superiority of 300,000, a figure notably closer to modern historical estimates than to Herodotus's overblown 3 million. Against this so-called effeminate horde stands the protagonists in perfect unity. Finally, there comes a simple exhortation that calls not merely for the preservation of autonomy, but the liberation of one's irrational and animalistic, even sexual passions. SOD are the first to impose metal's traditional expressions of masculinity, hedonism, and fascination with the dark side of human nature onto Sparta and its history. All of these themes are frequent throughout the 125 songs I have collected. Through metal's chaotic and Dionysian lens, Thermopylae was an opportunity to indulge in violent animal instincts to disrupt the forces of control. This is frequently illustrated not merely by appeals to the ecstasy of violence and bloodlust, but also by metaphors and similes that compare the Spartan hoplites to animal predators, specifically lions, in 13 different songs to be exact. This choice of animal likely draws from the meaning of Leonidas's name, which various songs render as son of the lion, the lion of Sparta, and even the lion king. This may also, consciously or not, recast the historical battle in a Homeric mold, as numerous warriors in the Iliad, like Diomedes and Aeneas, are compared to lions hunting their prey on the battlefield. These songs also compare, with a likewise Homeric pedigree, the quantity of blood spilled and the clashing of armies to the motions of rivers and seas. Yet the choice of lions also makes sense, in that lions are the only kitties that hunt in packs, and so a fitting analog for a phalanx that combines bestial violence with a sense of community. The Persians, on the other hand, like the sheepish Trojans slaughtered by the Leonine Diomedes, we would expect to be reduced to mammalian prey in these songs. Yet the animalization of the Persians is not in terms of animal predators and prey. Rather, they are reduced to animals in relation to humans. In a handful of songs, they become either sheep or cattle to be butchered or even killed like dogs, which in an ancient Greek context would mean to be left to rot unburied. Such similes, however, are only used by bands whose far-right allegiances are otherwise on full display, and we'll get to those. More often, though still troubling, the Persians are rendered as animals that pose a deadly threat to humans, often reduced to a singular collective monolith like a serpent or beast. This is owed in part to the 300 comic and film, quote, a beast approaches. It is equally telling that more than one band rhymes beast with east. This plays into the wider phenomenon of othering the Persians, along similar lines as the ancient Greeks characterized the so-called barbaroi, the barbarians. According to Aristotle and others, the subjects of the Persian king were natural slaves and inferior human beings who preferred their slavery, while the Greeks were natural masters. Such a dichotomy between Greek and, by extension, Western liberty, in their point of view, versus Eastern slavery, is evident throughout this catalog of songs, and even whole albums. Take the album Obsessed by War from the Greek band Unholy Archangel, whose cover art features a red figure vase painting from the early 5th century, attributed to the Triptolemus painter, of a long-haired Greek hoplite mastering an exotically dressed Persian soldier. The band frequently writes songs about the superiority of Greeks in war, not only the Spartans, but of those who conquered the peoples of Asia, namely Alexander, as well as the god Dionysus in his mythical conquest of India. True to their name, Unholy Archangel interspersed with these songs tracks with anti-Christian themes more typical of the black metal subgenre they play, forming a thematic unity where Christianity is seen, like the Persians, as a foreign nemesis of Hellenic culture. Like Scandinavian bands nostalgic for Vikingdom, and Italian bands for Roman glory, Greek bands like Unholy Archangel often seek to recover authentic national identity from times before and in spite of Christianity. In Songs of Thermopylae, Greek patriotism is often expressed through the unity of the Greeks, whereby the war against Persia anticipates a Greek nationhood not achieved until the 19th century War of Independence against the Ottomans. The song Eitan e Epitas by the Greek band Xenial is a notable example. Its lone mention of Helots fighting at Thermopylae suggests some form of inclusion of Greeks of all classes, while the song ends with a quotation from Aeschylus' tragedy, The Persians, the famous battle cry taken out of the context of the Battle of Salamis and into that of Thermopylae. Quote, on you now, sons of Hellas, free your native land, free your people, the fanes of your father's gods and the tombs of your ancestors. Now you battle for all. End quote. Some scholars see in these here lines one of the earliest expressions of pan-Hellenic, all-Greek spirit that would unite the squabbling city-states of the Greek mainland and islands. Like its people, the geography of Greece is also adapted to the metal ethos. Local hot springs gave Thermopylae its name, translated as hot gates, and less accurately, gates of fire, which in the Christianized paradigm in which heavy metal traditionally operates, becomes the gates of hell. Indeed, the Plutarchian apophthegm, tonight we dine in Hades, or more often hell, is often quoted in these songs, matched in frequency to references to Persian arrows blotting out the sun, which themselves enshroud the battlefield in a Stygian darkness. Several bands play with the notion of Thermopylae as the gates to the underworld. Once again, Hollywood often supplies the lyrics, into hell's mouth we march, and of course, tonight we dine in hell. These convey the Spartans' willful embrace of a warrior's death. In hindsight of the result of both the battle and the war, the Persians' entry through Thermopylae symbolizes their own death, as well as that of the Spartans guarding it. As the Greek band's Macabre Omen puts it, quote, I shall fall into the kingdom of Hades and ensure that I take with me worthless lives of those who stand in between the past, the present, and the future. Many bands rework the symbolism of Thermopylae geographically, going so far to imply that Greece is the kingdom of Hades itself and that the Spartans are its infernal legions. Quote, many have sung about the gates of fire, about the narrow way which leads to hell, sings the Finnish band Lord Vicar. Quote, now they're standing at the gates of fire, 300 men with blood desire, ready to die and make a stand. No one will pass through the gates of hell, writes the Greek band Tex. Only in death may the Persians descend to Hades. While with Greece being Hades, so the Greeks symbolize death itself. The German band Sacred Gate sings, quote, the Persians want to send us to hell, but they don't know. We are already the Styx, a river of blood. We are Hades. We are home now, end quote. Death for the Greeks is eagerly awaited like an Odyssean homecoming. Contrary to the realms of eternal gloom and punishment supplied by Greek and Christian mythology, the glamorization of hell has been a fundamental theme in heavy metal since the 1980s. The underworld's cacophonic opposition to the gods or god of the sky mirrors the heavy metal underground subculture that defines itself in opposition to the social, political, and religious institutions of the mainstream. In this paradigm, the kingdom of God, with its demands of moral austerity and obedience, amounts to a system of tyranny and enslavement. The kingdom of Satan, in contrast, represents the liberation from the bounds of morality and the indulgence of carnal passions, whether you call it Dionysus and chaos or sex, drugs, and rock and roll. It's with this mindset that several bands buy into Hollywood's distortion, itself drawing from ancient Greek misconceptions of Xerxes as a god-king, rather than the mortal viceroy of the Zoroastrian god Ahura Mazda. In heavy metal, the Spartans are the sentinels of hell, fighting not merely for political self-determination against foreign imperialism, but also personal autonomy against the tyranny of religion, especially one that claims a mortal man to be a god, be it Xerxes or Jesus. Greece, as the kingdom of hell, of heavy metal's natural opposition to the mainstream, thus fits into this traditional symbolism in the context of the Persian Wars, as the so-called bastion of liberty against slavery. While antipathy to religion is a common sentiment in metal, especially its more extreme subgenres, Thermopylae is not always a conflict of atheism and theism. Many Greek bands, influenced in part by the resurgence of neo-paganism, see Thermopylae as the struggle of their ancestral gods against the foreign gods of the East, be they Ahura Mazda, Xerxes, or the Christian God. If they don't believe in these gods literally, they are still symbols of their cultural heritage. Invoking yet again the Homeric interventions of gods on the battlefield, Zeus, Ares, and Heracles are all called upon as both the allies and ancestors of the Spartan race. Quote, "Thunder from the sky, gods of Olympus, marching by my side, Zeus, Soter, Nike, Ares, god of war, with Phobos and Deimos," sings the Italian band Holy Martyr. Like Homeric warriors in prayer, the Greek band's sacred blood pleads, quote, "Almighty Zeus of eternal Olympus, send your thunderbolts to your sons. Grant us with wrath to eradicate our enemies. Crimson-eyed god Ares, clang your sword on your shield, and let us hear your roar," unquote. Ares, as the god of irrational violence and bloodlust, is elevated from the buffoonish and seldom-worshipped god of the Iliad to a patron god of heavy metal, a syncretism of chaos and Dionysus. Such a preference for the berserker Ares signals a key conversion of the Spartans into heavy metal warriors. The near total absence in these lyrics of the discipline, austerity, and tactical cunning that was the basis for Sparta's military success and admiration by philosophers from Plato to Rousseau. The strategy of Athena and the rationality and order of Apollo, two of ancient Sparta's chief gods, are traded in for the bloodlust of Ares and the irrationality and chaos of Dionysus. The phalanx formation is occasionally mentioned, though most often as a symbol of brotherhood, like an audience of metalheads marshaled in a concert venue by the charisma of the performers. Yet unlike their counterparts who glorify the anarchic individuality of Vikings and other medieval warriors fighting for freedom or glory, Spartan-themed metal songs often place Spartan strength and bloodlust in the service of something beyond the individual. With 17 instances, four of which in the original Greek, the most oft-quoted ancient source in these songs, variously translated, is Simonides' epitaph. "Stranger, tell the Spartans that here we lie, obeying their words." They are, again, the injunction to stay in formation rather than retreat, even when outnumbered. Why the popularity of this epigram? I believe it shows that a law that demands one die a hero's death is one worth obeying. Moreover, it demonstrates that the Spartans place their law higher than any human authority, not even that of Leonidas, who, while presented as the ideal Spartan and inspiration to his men, is not the reason they chose to stand and fight and die. In this respect, Leonidas is different from Alexander or Julius Caesar, who in metal songs are often the sole focus. Here, rather, the focus is on collective action, while the charisma of their leader plays a secondary role. Yet the epitaph delivered in the first-person plural plays into another prevalent theme in these songs, and one that also has a Homeric lineage. That is the achievement of kleos, aphiton, of immortal fame by being sung about by, first by poets and now by metal bands. Simonides was the first poet to grant such eternal life, and so his epigram is used to suggest that metal songs serve to prolong the Spartans' immortality. From the very first song about the Spartans by S.O.D., these warriors followed Achilles in his choice of a short life with glory over a long life in obscurity. Yet through its glamorization of hell, they reject Achilles' later regret that it were better to be a serf on earth than a lord in Hades. But as we see in our current political climate, Sparta can be appropriated for more reasons than this, and can reflect a band's political conservatism. Metal has always had conservative tendencies traditionally, though that's changing. Metal began as a white working class phenomenon and built its identity by an antipathy to mainstream culture. White male working class phenomenon, I may add. Since the mainstream is now globalism and multiculturalism, Laconophilia metal may express the desire to preserve culture and retrieve an authenticity from the past. However, the appropriation of Sparta in metal is not evidence in itself that a band subscribes to any particular ideology. It is, in my opinion, perfectly reasonable to admire those who are willing to defend to the death their homeland against the invasion of a foreign power, and in general to champion society governed by a constitution of laws rather than a despot who is above the law. It is only when a band's ideology is made clear by other evidence that we can examine a song on Sparta as an expression of such views. One easy example of this is a band from next door in Indiana called Sons of Liberty, who, as their name suggests, put metal in the service of libertarianism. Their song, Molon Labe, itself a popular phrase among gun rights advocates, narrates Thermopylae as a thinly veiled manifesto against big government. Another example is more subtle and thus more prevalent. that of the Belgian band Ancient Rites. Its lead songwriter, Gunther Pace, has ties to Eurocentrism and the Neue Recht. Ancient Rites song Thermopylae is part of their 2006 album Rubicon, whose songs taken together added up to a celebration of European so-called Western civilization. The Spartans are here combined with the Crusaders, Julius Caesar, and Arminius as the touchstones of European heritage and defiance. Similarly, the Austrian band War Kings go so far as to embody this Western collective in their stage dress, each member playing under the pseudonyms of the Spartan, the Roman Tribune, the Viking, and the Crusader. While Thermopylae can serve the interests of pan-European conservatism against the perceived invasions of foreigners from the East, we also see it in the service of ultra-nationalists and neo-fascists, in the propaganda of both political groups and certain metal bands. Despite the vast majority of bands denying, truthfully or otherwise, that their music serves any political agenda, as an inherently contrarian art form, extreme music can attract and express extreme views. For instance, a number of Greek bands have close ties to the far-right party Golden Dawn, which meets at Thermopylae once a year, wielding torches and renewing their anti-immigrant resolve. One of these, the band Nair Mataran, sets these sentiments to music. Quote, "I hold the heart and soul of an ancient Spartan. Destroy now the plague from the east. I hear the voice of Leonidas standing at Thermopylae. I attack in the east by the side of Alexander the Great." End quote. Another Greek band, Der Stürmer, which takes its name from the most popular anti-Jewish newspaper in Hitler's Germany, goes so far as to openly advocate Greek Nazism. Their song, "Those Who Lived and Died Like Heroes," is an ode to the 300 that dehumanizes the Persians as an inferior race. Quote, "Death to those who bow before a foreign king. Like dogs they shall die, like servants they lived." And we heard that rhetoric just this past week from somebody. It strikes us as deeply ironic that such a song about the defense of Greece from a foreign power is on an album whose cover artwork is a photograph of the Nazi flag planted in 1941 CE on the very Acropolis that Xerxes had torched to ashes in 480 BCE. However, the band likely subscribes to the Nazi myth that the so-called and now debunked invasion of the Spartans' Dorian ancestors into Greece around the end of the Bronze Age was in fact an Aryan invasion from Germany. Hitler's seizing of the Acropolis symbolizes a reclamation of Greece for her Aryan brethren. As shown also by the use of the Leonidas statue in modern Sparta for the album Iron Will and Discipline, Der Stürmer embraced the alleged kinship between Germany and Greece and the eugenic policies of ancient Spartan and modern fascist society. Such problematic appropriations of Sparta in metal music, as in contemporary culture at large, can be challenged if we set the record straight and promote a more critical view of Spartan society. Sparta's depiction in metal music is wholly positive and exemplary, not least because of the nearly exclusive focus on its role in the Persian Wars. Virtually none offer what can be taken as a more critical view, one that exposes in a negative light the darker sides of Spartan civilization, such as eugenics, pelletage, and xenophobia. The lack of more critical takes on Sparta is inconsistent with other popular subjects of metal's reception of ancient history. A few songs exist that reevaluate the character and legacy of Alexander, and several more denounce the imperialism of Rome. A musical genre with rebellion in its DNA would be well poised to expose the dystopian underbelly of the Lycurgan utopia. And I'll conclude on that note. Sparta in metal music, as in its reception throughout history, persists and thrives because of its adaptability. While historically rooted in Greece and constituted of a peculiar system of laws, education, and economics, the Spartans, and especially their last stand at Thermopylae, have a significance that, while readily tied to nationality and ideology, easily transcends those things and resonates with the core of heavy metal. Though centered on musical performance, the metal subculture treats feelings of social alienation and disempowerment by instilling a sense of belonging to a group which is itself united by its antipathy to various hegemonic institutions. The sense of power inspired by the music can take the form of an historic individual or group who overcomes challenges and defines its very identity as the adversary of the mainstream. With their long hair, spirit of defiance, and quest for immortal fame, the Spartans live on as heavy metal heroes. Thanks.
very much. How about some questions for Dr. Swiss? I know you're Leonidas and come out with it.
Do you have a favorite song or that specifically discusses Sparta and Leonidas?
I'm so glad you asked that question. Way to start, thank you. I think my favorite, I've been doing, listening to a lot of this stuff lately. My favorite is probably, there's four concept albums, and one of them is the concept album Tides of War by a German band Sacred Gate, mm-hmm. It's my favorite musically. It came out a couple years ago, but it's traditionally in the vein of classic heavy metal, so I like it for that reason. But I like how it explores more sides of the conflict than just the battle itself. So for instance, it begins with a song where basically the war god Ares is speaking in the first person, and essentially he's addressing the Spartans. And here we have, again, the calling himself somebody who represents chaos and bloodlust, and bringing the Spartans to fight. And then the rest of the album is essentially a narration of the events starting in 490 with the Earth and Water incident, going all the way to the end, to the aftermath of Thermopylae. And there's also included songs about the heroes saying goodbye to their wives and daughters and sisters in Sparta, which is, you know, it's an acoustic track, and it's very well placed. And so, Tides of War by Sacred Gate is definitely my favorite of this whole bunch.
I have a question.
Yeah.
You referenced Salamis in one of your charts, and I'm wondering if this genre picks up on the 300 sort of differences between Spartans and Athenians. Do Athenians ever appear in this music?
Rarely. If you're talking about Athenian mythology, there's lots of songs of Theseus and the Minotaur and that kind of stuff. But in terms of Athenians in actual history, Salamis is referenced maybe a couple times as sort of secondary or, kind of the inevitable result as a result of Thermopylae in some of these songs. Which I find unfortunate that Thermopylae sucks up all of the attention, because there's so much rich history right in the 5th century. Like, I'd love to see more songs about the Peloponnesian War. There might be one song, I think there's one song that even makes mention of it. And I think, as I was mentioning at the end, some songs that might look at Sparta more critically might look at the Peloponnesian War for that, where we had almost 300 Spartans surrender at Spacteria at the Battle of Pylos, for instance. Yeah, so, yeah, if you're in bands, write songs about Athens. We need to balance things out.
The films really impose homosexuality on Athenians as if it's not on the Spartans, right? So there's ways in which they're doing a lot of gender and sexuality coding with that distinction.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and definitely that's going on in these songs overall.
Other questions?
Yeah.
So with the kind of new releases of this second 300 and the new Assassin's Creed game, there is a more female presence in those roles, and while metal is a male-dominated genre, has there been more female presence in these Spartan songs now that there's these new exposures that they're, being told about, I guess?
Unfortunately, it doesn't seem to be the case. Like I mentioned in that Tides of War album, there's the one song about, the wives and daughters saying goodbye, and that seems to be one of the rare references to Spartan women, besides maybe we give birth to real men. And even that song sort of reinforces kind of the gendered distinctions musically, where the male-focused songs on battle are plugged. They're the big, loud, turn to 11 songs, whereas this song focusing more on the women is an acoustic track, okay? So enforcing that distinction. That said, I did not look at the lineup of all of these bands in detail to see if there were some women musicians taking part, but generally this seems to be all male bands doing this, though classical reception in metal, bands with female members do have plenty of songs about classical heroines like Cassandra and Medea. There's a lot on Medea, and a few others like Cleopatra and Boudica. Boudica is, you can imagine rebellion, okay, fits into this a lot. Okay. So yeah, more,
We need more songs on Sparta, focusing on Spartan women.
Any other questions? Okay, please join me in thanking Dr. Swist again.